We'll give you a second.
We work it by all the way.
Yeah.
And the totality, you could get Y with one or Y with X one or Y with one, X one plus X two. It'll give you a different amount of units.
I was actually just talking about this. The reason why is because inside of the log likelihood for the negative binomial, you'll have a term that looks like this. Okay? And what's happening is, and this is actually the problem that we're running into right now with the saturated models, I think as well for the likelihood ratio. What's happening is, based upon your model, you get an estimate about that, and that estimate is changing if you've just got an intercept in the model, or if you've just got X1 in the model, or if you've just got X2 in the model. And it's just using that each time. And so this term is ending up inside of that deviance, the scale that's there. Okay? And so, of course, if alpha is pushing down towards zero, then this thing is okay. Or I'm sorry, if alpha is pushing towards one, then this thing is going to be okay, right? It's going to go away. But you don't have that luxury.
Yes. So for a different model, you could have, that means you actually have different null, right?
Exactly. And it's because the variance is tied in there. So part of the variance, anyways, is tied in there. If it were just dependent upon mu, everything would be the same, right? Like in the Poisson model, because all those models would basically, the null model would be defined to just be the intercept in the model, so mu half would be the same for every observation, and you wouldn't have a problem. But because alpha has changed, it's conditioning upon that, it's changing each time. So that, and this is the reason why the saturated log likelihood is different as well. Is because it's conditioning upon that. So. Yep. So. Just at pairwise residual plots. Again, the idea here is you want to focus on the residuals because you want to pull up the systematic components of what's going on. Right? So you want something to mean zero. So then if I start looking at residuals, if I take the expectation of say squared residuals, that's pretty easy, right? That's how the variance of those guys is all in, right? Or if I want to think about the covariance between two residuals, that's just going to be the product of those things, right? I'm looking at the expectation. I don't have to worry about the means anymore because I will have pulled out the systematic component. So let's start by doing that. Usually, again, these are for diagnostic tools. So usually when I want to mean center those residuals, say as a function of time, I want to be fairly flexible in how I'm modeling time. In other words, if you just throw in a linear term for time, you might not be fitting the functional form right. So those residuals at any particular point in time might not have mean zero, another cross-sectional, because you mismodeled the mean. You guys with me on that? I mean, think about it. If the trajectory were quadratic and I fit a straight line through it, I'm going to have positive residuals at one point in time, negative residuals at another point in time, positive residuals at another point. I want to avoid that. So I want to be flexible in how I'm pulling out the systematic mean over time. So the way that I'm going to do that, something I will often do is I use something called a natural spline. If you think about a natural spline, have I talked about natural splines to you guys yet? No. Okay. Just to give you a little bit of intuition, I hate throwing out this function and saying here. We've been using splines enough in our smoothing enough in this class where I might give you guys a discussion on the smoothers in general, but to give you guys an idea of what a natural spline does, if you think about, in our case, we're thinking about time. Thinking about CD4 counts. Let's go ballistic for the problem. That's a little bit of CD4 counts kind of moving around like this, and then hit times zero, and then coming down like this. Okay. So, this is zero, right about here. So that's zero conversion. So, basically, if you think about a flexible fit for a curve, if I took a very small interval of time in this case, a line is going to approximate that pretty well, right? In other words, if I start coming down, I can start approximating this curve with just pairwise lines as I'm going through, okay? And as I kind of widen this, I might want to expand that from being linear to say quadratic to cubic or something like that to get more and more flexibility, right? If I start fitting like a fourth order polynomial to this thing, what is likely to happen is I'll get influence on the tails. Fourth order polynomial might start looking something like that, right? And I'll get this like poor fitting over here on the tails, so you end up getting kind of influence on the boundaries. So you want to avoid that, and so the way that splines avoid that is they take, it's a very intuitive concept, they divide the data. And where you divide that, we call these things knots. So you can literally think about it as just putting a divider line there. And then saying, okay, now I'm going to fit this thing locally. Right? And then I'm going to fit this locally, and I'll fit this locally, and I'll fit this locally. Okay? And so you can imagine, again, one possibility is I could just fit lines in there. Oops. Oh, no, I don't want one. Sorry. Lines in there, like that. That's probably not optimal for you, though, right? I mean, in terms of, it's discontinuous, so that's number one. So you probably don't want that. I mean, really what we want is some smooth functions going through these things. Okay. So now I can say, okay, well, I can force in continuity. And you can see then that that's going to make, that's going to create influence from neighbors, right? If I force in continuity, the interval next to me is going to force my line to change a little bit. I mean, we're going to have to compromise for this week to meet, okay? And so the idea behind something called a B-spline, which we deal with, is not to fit a line here, but really to fit a cubic polynomial. So now a B-spline would say, I'm going to fit my best-fitting cubic here. And what it does at the end of the day is something fairly clever, which says, and at any particular point in the knot, what I will do is I will force the first and second derivatives, I'll force continuity, but also force the first and second derivatives of that curve to be equal. And what that does is that creates something visually to yourself that looks very smooth. So think about just a cubic polynomial here, a cubic polynomial here, but I put a constraint on it where when these things meet up, not only are they continuous, they have equal values at z2, but also the first and second derivatives in z2 are also equal to one another. Okay? And so at the end of the day then, you get something that looks like this. So I've got a polynomial inside. There is influence that's coming across these different intervals, but it looks smooth to my eye. And I've broken off the heavy influence from this side, influencing over here, which is my first drawing that I had. That intuitively okay for everybody right now? I mean, there's a lot of details going on, but I want you to get the general picture. So a natural spline does one other thing. It forces at the boundaries that thing to be linear. In other words, forces the first derivatives down to being constant. And so the reason it does that is because when you have nothing else to borrow off of to pull you back in, you can still get odd shapes that kind of come up on the boundaries. And so a natural spline just says, right over here, this thing has to be linear, right at the boundary of my data points, and similarly back over here. Okay? So again, for your purposes, when I fit this natural spline, really what I'm doing is I'm dividing my data. You're going to see where I put in knots for where I divide my data. I'm fitting a local cubic polynomial, and then I'm putting some constraints on that thing to make it smooth as I go from one knot to the next knot to the next knot to the next knot. Everybody okay with that? Just intuitively? Seem like a reasonable thing to do? Yes?
Why are the second derivatives also equal?
Because if you just have your first derivatives being equal, you actually see kind of sharp points still. It turns out that as the second derivatives become equal, visually to your eye, you really can't even tell now that this is not a smooth curve. And you're actually going to see it in just a second. But that's the reason why. And you could force in, so the idea behind, for example, a B-spline in general is you could take P, the polynomial with inside of each one of these, to be as high as you want. So I can make it a seventh degree polynomial. And what that would do then at the end of the day is for a B-spline, it forces the first six derivatives to be. So it's always P minus one. So if I take, when we say a cubic spline, that means first and second derivatives being equal to one another. So it's always P minus one. As you go. Yeah.
And it's only like practical up to three dimensions?
The point is, well, there's a trade-off here, right? Because if I were to take this thing and make these intervals bigger, I might have to have a bigger degree polynomial to fit things reasonably well. But most people would just simply say, well, I'll just take a third degree, so that means that I have continuity between these things. And if I need more flexibility, I'll put in more knots. You know what I mean? So usually there's no need to go higher than like a third degree polynomial from a practical perspective, because if I'm not fitting well, I can just add in more knots.
But also meant like if you have more than one predictor. So could we go in like 3D space or higher than that would be just too much?
You can. Those are called tensor products. Okay, so that's like spans out these B splines. So there's a whole build on this, right? So now if I wanted to interact, for example, two different smoothers or have a bivariate smoother, that's called a tensor product in this case. Okay? So I don't want to go too far into that right now because I'm using them as a diagnostic tool. But I want you guys to understand when I'm calling NS, I'm just trying to get a smooth fit that's coming through here, and I'm trying to minimize the device that I might have on the boundaries by these things going up or down. Okay.
So why don't you just use like low S?
I could use low S as well, but low S tends to get influence on the boundaries over here as well. And I'm trying to avoid that as much as I can. So the natural spline is a very good way of doing that to kind of force this thing to be linear. Because low S takes like the local, remember we've talked about low S certainty, that's like a local average. Well, as I start getting over here, there's nothing for me to borrow off of on the right. So you again start to get these boundary effects that call them in smoothing literature. Okay. So I'm trying to avoid that a little bit in the residuals here. Okay.
Yes?
Did
you just eyeball the knots?
For our purposes, I'm going to take the knots to basically be spaced. Yeah, so if you were doing this in practice though, if you wanted to put a smoother in and your goal was to build a model to predict CD4, then what would you likely do? Go back to 211 days. I wouldn't just eyeball the knots. I would try lots of different knot locations and I would assess what? Yeah, exactly. The out-of-sample prediction error, either through something like AIC or cross-validation or something else. So that, I mean, that becomes part of the routine. Is it my goal or really to just build a perfect predictive, what a perfect predictive model, CD4 over time? I would really be going back to our old prediction criteria and saying, I'll try lots of different knots and locations of those knots until I get a quote-unquote optimal model there. Okay. That's not really my goal right now, myself. My goal is really to roughly detrend these data and minimize the bias that I might have on the boundary. So you're going to see me basically take some equal spaces here and fit a cubic in between. Okay. So would it be useful to have kind of a discussion on smooth a little bit more, like where you can actually see this? You know, I can give you guys like a little lecture where I write down exactly how the sets are generated. It's not fully obvious. We'll do that. Let's do VBA right now. So what I am doing here, again, as I go through this, is I'm first going to fit a model where I'm putting in now a natural spline, and the knots that I'm using here are at minus 2, 0, 2, and 4. So this goes back to Monticello's question. If you go back to my plot here, what I'm doing is I'm putting in a knot here. You think about dividing up the data right there, right here, and right here, and I'm going to fit a polynomial inside of each one and force it. So, and again, I'm just picking that really kind of equally spaced across my time, so measurement. Okay. The nice thing is that polynomial fit there, even though you have all these kind of odd constraints, you can write down a design matrix for it, right? For all the, it's just a transformation of the X space, right? If I fit a single polynomial, it would look like X squared and X cubed. Now I'm fitting these individual polynomials with constraints, it still can be written as transformations of my predictors. Okay, so I can fit a linear model to that thing and get back fits from it. So now I'm going to just take the fitted values off of that, so you can think about these as the quote-unquote predicted means of CD4 at any point in time. And I'm going to take my observed CD4 values now and then create residuals off of that. So now it's just kind of like a good old OLS model based upon time. I'm not worried about correlation. There's obviously autocorrelation, all this stuff. I'm just trying to detrend the mean. Okay, so you know that's modeling. Okay, so then I'm going to do a few things. I'm going to compute the number of observations that I have in the data set. I showed you guys that already. I'm going to compute the number of subjects that I have. And I'm going to create this thing I'm going to call R matrix, so or R mat for residual matrix. And that's going to be divided up over 7 time frames. So what I'm doing is I'm just going to think about different year categories. And the goal at the end of the day here is to visualize the correlation structure. So I'm going to chunk up the data into, say, minus 2 years or 2 years prior to zero conversion, 1 year prior to zero conversion, the year around zero conversion, etc. So I'm just dividing things up over time so I can start to visualize what's going on. So that's what I mean by YCAT. It's a year category. The next thing I'm doing is I'm creating now, if you look at the split here, so what this is doing is counting how many observations are per each subject here, so that's NJ, so that's just the number of observations per subject. Again, I could have done that multiple ways. One way to do that would be with the table of a table function. That would have been fun too. I'm going to create a function that I call myBin. All my code is up online for you guys, by the way. There's nothing fancy here, it's just that you take the minimum function and you've got NAs that are stuck in there, it will default giving you an NA back. Okay? I want to just take the minimum, removing all of the some values. Okay? Which is an option inside of min, but I just find it easier to just have my own functions to do such things. Okay? So if I've got any missing values here, let me throw things back. Okay? And then finally, I'm going to run through for each of my year categories. What I'm going to do is I'm going to take all observations that are plus or minus 0.5. So what that means is plus or minus 6 months, right, on the side of either year. So if I'm at time zero, I go out to 6 months prior to zero conversion, 6 months after zero conversion. Okay? And so those are going to be the legal quote-unquote observations at any particular year categories. And I'm going to apply cycle through the year categories. I don't really need to do this right now because individuals were pretty much randomly measured over time. But if you had sampling by design where everybody got measured at day 32, for example, and you go to plot values as a function of time, they're all going to lay on top of one another, right? You guys with me on this? I mean, if I plot it as a function of time and everybody's measured at the exact same time, then all the values will lay right on top of one another. I want to avoid that oftentimes to visualize things, so I'm just going to jitter time, because that's all JT is just jittering time, adding a little bit of noise to it. And again, I don't really need it for this example, because time is already effectively jittered, because people are randomly coming back. However, I put it in here just so you guys can have it in the future, if you're going to use this. T0, then, what I'm doing here is I'm taking each individual's observed time, and then I'm taking the difference between that time and the anchor point that I have, and I'm taking the minimum point around that. So what I want is I want the point closest to 0, the point closest to 1, the point closest to 2. Okay, and that's the point I'm going to keep. Because okay? Some individuals might have gotten measured twice within the same 6-month period. And then finally, when I keep these things, now there, that's my closest point relative to TJ, I'm then just going to pull my residuals off and then store them into what I'm calling YJ here. Okay, so now at the end of the day, this YJ represents the residuals that are all kind of contained within a plus or minus 6-month period around each of my anchor points, minus 2, minus 1, 0, 1, 2. So let me run that and I'll show it to you so you can see what's going on. So I'll just throw some dim names up there. And if you look at RMAT, what you will see is, as I'm going through, around year 2, the very first subject doesn't have anything going on. You know, so they didn't have a measurement at minus 2 years, plus or minus 6 months. Then they came into the study, they have a measurement minus 1 year prior to zero conversion, plus or minus 6 months, and this is their residual from the fit, okay, their mean-centered residual. At year 0, this is around zero conversion, and then they actually dropped out of study, okay? So they didn't have anything coming up after that. This individual had 4 measures pre and then post, okay, as you're going through. So those are just each individual's residual, and the goal of me doing that, well, there's going to be a lot of goals of doing that, but one of them is I'm going to produce a Paris plot of those residuals. So now it's kind of just looking at pairwise cross plots of, go back to this guy, of say year minus 2 versus year minus 1 versus year 0, etc. So the outcome of that then is the following. So what this is allowing me to do is to visualize for each individual how their residuals are relating to one another. So if that's a minus 2 years versus minus 1 year versus 0 years, etc. Okay, so now you guys got to help me try and make sense of this. Okay, so what do you see on this thing? What is it?
Yeah, it's sort of clustered to 0.
So first of all, let me ask you a question. Does it look like there's within-subject correlation?
Yes. Yeah.
Absolutely, right? I mean, for example, take year 2 to year 3. Those things are super highly related, right? Those are the two residuals, right? So they're definitely correlated with inside of a subject, because one goes high, the other one is going high. Okay, so I mean, that's obvious. You can start to see that. Does it look like there's correlation that's high and then starts to dissipate as a function of time? To some degree, you can start to see it, right? I see some folks saying, well, kind of maybe. Let's take, for example, year 1 versus year 2. You see this thing starting to widen out into a cloud as you're going farther and farther in time? That's what that's doing. That's what that's telling you, okay? As you start moving farther and farther away in time, some of these clouds are starting to get wider. The other thing is that you start seeing other aspects up here, which, what's going on here? Well, the thing I have to worry about now is I've got sparsity in data, right? I don't have a lot of individuals for which I have a measurement at minus 2 years and then a measurement at 4 years out past zero conversion. In other words, either they're going to be 7 years apart totally. Okay? And so I don't have a lot of individuals there. What that means for me is I won't be able to estimate covariance parameters very well going out 7 years, right? Because I've got very few individuals that are there. So that's another take-home message from this. Okay. So I tend to find these types of plots good for trying to explain to folks, yeah, look, you know, as I start moving farther away from your three, I start getting a lot of lack of correlation. And by the way, as you start moving, say, year three over to here, say, minus year one, you probably are going to start to see a lot less correlation. That's because at this point in time, at year minus one, this person didn't have HIV. This is 3 years after having HIV. So that's going to do a whole lot of changes to their CD4 counts over that amount of time, right? So it's totally natural that you'd start to see these things. Clouds kind of blow up pre versus post, okay? HIV infection, okay? Okay, so that is a pairs plot for the residuals to allow you to visualize a little bit of what's going on. And again, part of this is you seeing things, parsing the data, but also part of it is you explaining the impact of correlation, the presence of correlation inside of the data set to somebody else. So we're going to get a little bit more out of those residuals. We're going to compute empirical correlation matrices, covariance matrices, and then we'll look at sample size as well. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to go for each one of my time points here. I'm going to simply count how many observations that I have for each of those time points. So I'm just counting the dots that were inside of each of those pairwise plots that I just showed you. But then I'm also going to compute this thing I call SJK. And so what I mean by that for SJK is I'm simply looking at the empirical variance now between any two observations. So I'm taking the residual at time J versus the residual at time K and multiplying them up. Again, they have mean zero, so this is an estimate of their covariance. You guys with me? Then when I sum those guys and divide by N, I now have an estimate of the covariance for time J versus time K. If I assume that that was constant across individuals. Okay. Just a simple mean there. So, what you have when I print out that covariance matrix, then this is actually an empirical estimate of the covariance when I'm looking at time minus 2 versus, say, time minus 1, time minus 2 versus time minus 3, etc., etc. Down the diagonals, I have an estimate of what the variance is for those residuals at each of those point in time. Okay? So a couple of things here. What do you notice about the variance? What's that?
They're not very equal.
Yeah, they're not equal, and in particular, there's kind of a change point. Where does the change point occur?
Zero?
Super high variance, super high variance. Big variance, coming to smaller variance, small, small. What happened right here?
Zero convergence.
Zero convergence, right? Everybody's starting to sink in on one another. You can see it already, right? The variance is starting to come down because everybody's CD4 counts are starting to push down. Okay. Back here, everybody was healthy. There was just like randomly drawn from the population. There's a ton of variation in the population in CD4 counts. Okay. So that's one thing. You can also start to see, it's hard to see because you have to take into account the variance now for each of these things, but you start seeing decreases here. So the better thing to probably do is to remove the individual variances and just look at estimates of the correlation now between any two time points. Well, how can I do that? I can take the covariance and I can divide by the square root of the two variances, right? That's just an empirical estimate of the correlation. Covariance divided by the square root of the two variances. So the correlation matrix comes out quite easy from that. And if I print that guy, that's now an empirical estimate of my correlation. So what do we start seeing there? So it's looking like, so first of all, these data are not independent. So that's one. These things are not zero on the diagonals for sure. As I start stepping off, I have a correlation estimate of about 0.6. That starts to come down. It's going to be variable as you go through because they're just empirical estimates, but you can see over 5 years and 6 years that thing starts to come down. Oh, and then it shoots all the way up to 0.84. Yeah, you got to think about this relative to the amount of information that you have, right? And so that's exactly why I tend to produce alongside that at all points in time an in matrix. And so what am I computing that correlation estimate on? 9 individuals. Okay. So these are the number of observations that I have to be able to estimate that thing. Okay. So I wouldn't be trusting things that are sitting way off in the upper right tail, is what I'm saying. You're trying to get a general idea of what's happening here. So what I start seeing in a plot like this is that correlation is starting to dissipate as a function of time. It's not a huge autoregressive process. It's not kind of this linearly just dropping down, but there's definitely within subject correlation, and it does dissipate as I move farther and farther out. You know, as you go out from 0.76, 0.61, et cetera, et cetera. Okay. Good. So what this is telling me then is if I'm going to choose some reasonable, at least at this point in time, some reasonable working correlation structure, I probably don't want to choose independence. Okay? For the weighting. There's some evidence here of a serial process, so I probably want to do something more AR rather than exchangeable. Is with me? Okay. All right. So now, those are well and good, but I think that there's even one slightly better. I think these are good for explaining to individuals, but there's one slightly better diagnostic for the correlation structure, at least from my perspective, to focus on. And that is this concept of a variable ground, okay, which is kind of probably a new concept for you guys. So a variable ground is trying to get it a way to visualize 3 components of variation. It starts off with a theoretical model, and it's a pretty flexible theoretical model, I would argue, in that it captures the 3 types of processes that we would generally think about as describing longitudinal or spatially correlated data. And so this guy was proposed ultimately or initially by Peter Diggle, so he's one of the authors on your guys' textbook. And so what Peter had done was he'd said, okay, look, I can think about decomposing some correlation process into 3 components. And if you go back to when I introduced kind of a hybrid correlation structure, I took a hybrid between a random intercept model, where I had a random, just this constant correlation, so it was exchangeable, and then plus an AR structure, right? And the benefit of that was it allowed me to have a dissipating correlation through time, which is kind of natural, but then also to have a long-term correlation as time goes off to infinity, the distance between 2 measurements, maintaining that correlation being non-zero. Okay, so if you go back to that hybrid thing, that's what I was doing there. It also allowed me to then think about measurement error, which is as 2 observations come close to one another, there's still a correlation less than 1 between those observations. Go back to my notes on this. Yes?
In the homework, you say that WI follows a normal.
Not in this particular case. That's a model I gave to you in the homework, right? I'm introducing something very general here. WI does not necessarily follow any distribution whatsoever.
Yeah, what would that mean, have a function follow a distribution?
What I said was the WI that I had, I wanted you to generate random deviates having that particular distribution so you can induce correlation with what was happening there.
Yeah.
Okay. So don't get confused with what I've got here, right? This is a serial process. So, by the way, functions can have distributions, but you can think about like Yaskin processes.
I was also a little bit confused about your notation homework. Uh-huh. So you said that wi of dij, mm-hmm. So you use this, and then you say that wi is normally distributed. Mm-hmm. So I assume that basically you're just taking the jth component, but just to clarify.
Yeah. Exactly. And all I'm doing on the homework is getting you guys to visualize if I had kind of a random effect, right, that's changing as a function of time. And I'm just putting the distribution on that so you can induce some correlation structure through that random effect. That's not, don't get confused with the limitations though. Sorry, just take this one condition upon it for just a second, okay? I just got this process, right? I've got xij beta, alpha I, wi, tij, plus epsilon ij. Okay. Okay, and again, the 3 sources really that Diggle was trying to include here is one is to say, I have this random intercept which is always existing, right? It's the ith individual tends to be higher or lower. Again, you can think about it just like that than the rest of the population, okay? And that's gonna be inherent in that ith individual. There's this serial process, which we're gonna put some sort of a structure on in just a second, which is going to be a function of time as I'm moving through time. And then again, there's this quote-unquote measurement error process, epsilon ij. Okay. And so, the proposed model that's going to give rise to the underlying variogram that we're going to look at here says all these components are independent of one another, so they're errors, right? And they're independent of one another, so that now my variance of alpha I has some nu squared. The covariance between this random error that's coming into play between any time s and t looks like this autoregressive process where I've got some sigma squared for the variance on them and then some correlation that's dependent upon the distance between those two measurements. Okay. This is not raised to the s minus t right now, it's just a general function, right? It says rho of the absolute difference between s and t. And then finally, that measurement error process, I'm going to call that tau squared, okay, just for defining this guy. All right. So far, so good? Okay. All right. Now, Stephen, going back to your point, I could put a normal on these things, right? But I'm not doing that right now. I mean, in other words, I could say that the W's are multivariate normal, but they're not. But I'm not making that assumption. I'm just making an assumption about the covariance. Okay. So, if you then take that model, so that was for an individual observation yij, if I take that model then and look at the covariance between yij and yij prime, where these things are independent, the covariance between any two observations on the same sampling unit now that has distance tij minus tij prime is going to look like nu squared. That's that intrinsic correlation, again, coming from the random intercept on an individual. It's going to look like sigma squared times whatever this function is for the distance between those two measurements on that individual. And then it's going to look like this measurement error term when j approaches j prime, when they actually hit each other. Okay? So if I take j equal to j prime, I get this. And if I don't have j equal to j prime, then this thing looks like tau squared. Okay? Okay. Good. So now, what we want to do is create something that is going to allow us to visualize the three components. That's the underlying goal of the variogram, is to say, do I have a large value of nu squared? Do I have a contribution from this sigma squared times this function rho? And do I have a contribution from this tau squared that's there? So I'm trying to assess if I have these three components or which one of the three I have. Okay. And so, what does the variogram do? Well, the variogram is defined as this function, we'll call it gamma of u, such that if you've got this random process, or quote unquote stochastic process, x of t, that's running through time, you look at 1/2 times the expected value of xt plus u minus xt squared. Sorry. Where now I'm looking at a distance of u between any two measurements, okay? And the key thing here is that these things are assumed to have mean zero. So when I do that, what am I really looking at here?
Variance.
Or covariance. Between x of t plus u and s of t, right? That's what I'm getting at here, between those two observations. So now, let's think about the covariance for a model where, see, what you guys have is originally, you guys have things that are not necessarily mean zero. What we're going to do is we're going to think about, okay, well, we're building a model for that response. So call this CD4 counts in your particular case on the ith individual. What we're going to do is we're going to subtract off our estimated mean for that. So when we get a random variable that has approximately mean zero, and then we're going to assume an autoregressive process such that rho as time goes to 0 is equal to 1. In other words, as I push in, I get 1 back. And as time between two observations goes off to infinity, I get 0. OK? okay? So that's kind of like your good old AR process, I believe we were talking about earlier, right? As time pushes in, correlation goes to one. As time goes out to infinity between two observations, correlation goes down to zero. So now, let's look for a second at the empirical variable frame here, okay? So we'll start this guy up and see if we can write it down. It's allowing for a hybrid type, exactly. It's allowing for that common correlation, and then it's allowing also correlation to go down in it as well as measurement there. Exactly. Okay. So again, let's revisit. So the definition of the variogram function in this case looks like gamma of u, right? I should keep this at u, not mu. Equaling 1/2 times the expected value now of x at t plus u minus x at t squared. And we're assuming we have a model for our response such that the covariance between yij and yij prime is, again, has a form where you have this intrinsic correlation within a subject that's coming from the random intercept plus a sigma squared times some function rho that looks like tij minus tij prime, the difference or the distance between those observations that are measured, and then plus an indicator of whether j is equal to j prime times this measurement error term tau squared. Okay, so as that distance comes down to zero, and in other words, j is equal to j prime, the time of those measurements become the same, I get back this tau squared, so a measurement error. So from that, again, this is just falling off of my notes, I want to define now random variable xit or xi star evaluated at time t. And what that's going to be is, again, yi evaluated at time ti minus the covariance in my model evaluated at time t times beta. Okay? So I'm mean centering my response. The xi star now has mean zero to fit back into the framework of this variogram. Then if we look at the variogram function and we evaluate it now, it simply looks like xi star t plus u squared, like that, minus 2 times the expectation xi star t plus u xi star at time t, and then finally plus an expectation of xi star at t quantity squared. Okay, so all I did was just multiply everything out, where again, the general definition of a variogram is a process that has mean zero. I mean center my responses. Now I'm going to just write this thing out in terms of those mean centered responses. Okay. So what does this guy come up to be then for a variogram? So it looks like I've got this guy here and this guy here. Well, what are those two guys? This is the expectation of xi star squared, right, at a particular point in time. It has mean zero, so that is equal to its variance. Its variance is equal to the variance of this yi. What is the variance of that yi? It's nu squared plus, at the same time, right, sigma squared, so that's going to be a 1, plus a tau squared. J is equal to J prime, right, at the exact same time, since the variance of an observation at one time. Okay? So now I'm going to have 1 half, I'll get a nu squared plus sigma squared plus tau squared there. I'll get the same thing right there, right? Same, this is going to be the variance. It's just at a different point in time, but it's just that common variance. This thing, when I take this out, where these two things are equal to one another, it's not going to be a function of time anymore, right? So now, what I've got is 1 half times 2 nu squared plus sigma squared plus tau squared. And now what about this guy in the middle? So this is the expectation of xi star t plus u times xi star t. That's the covariance, right? They both have mean 0. So now go back up to the covariance between those two observations. It looks like nu squared plus now sigma squared rho evaluated at u, right? And then this term goes away. That's not there anymore, right? So I'm not measuring these guys at the same time. So now I get a minus 2 nu squared plus sigma squared times rho evaluated at u, the distance between those two measurements. And so if you write this guy down, or simplify it just a little bit, you'll get a sigma squared back times a 1 minus rho of u plus tau squared, this measurement error concept, right? So nu squared is canceled because you're within the same observation here when you took these differences. So a couple of things about this to realize. So we're going to use this function to try and decompose these different components here. So we're going to try and estimate gamma of u. Okay, that's the whole point here. So a couple of notes, though, about what gamma of u comes out to be is that as u starts pushing towards 0, then what's happening with gamma of u? Well, u, again, that's the distance in time between two measurements, right? So what I'm saying is those two measurements becoming instantaneously close to one another, okay? Well, what's happening with gamma of u is that rho of u is starting to push towards rho evaluated at 0 at that point. And what happens as rho starts to evaluate at 0? It goes to 1, right? So this thing goes away now. Okay, so now I get rho of u starts going towards 1, which implies then that gamma of u, that variogram, starts pushing towards tau squared. You guys with me? So as time is pushing in, I get back this tau squared aspect. Yeah, exactly, the measurement error component. Okay, then now think about the opposite. As u starts going off to infinity, in other words, the distance between two measurements, the time between two measurements starts going way, 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 way far away, rho of u starts going off to 0, right? And what I'm left with then is that gamma of u starts pushing off to sigma squared plus tau squared. Okay. So what this means for us is that we can think about a delta time, right, as time is moving on. So that's the u in my case, right? So it's the difference in time between two measurements. So as I start moving out in time and taking two measurements, and I look at what gamma of u is, this variogram, you can say, okay, well, I'm going to draw a horizontal line up here, and this horizontal line, I want to make sure I get the order right, is nu squared plus sigma squared plus tau squared which is total variation, right? That's the variance of a single observation. That's the total variance. It's captured by three components here. Intrinsic correlation within the subject that creates variation across the population. The serial process as time is pushing down towards zero. And then finally, as you get to the time difference being towards zero, or like delta t to zero, the measurement error process. Okay. A variogram is in general going to have a form that looks kind of like so. And we're going to talk about what this means here. So we've already written down the function over here. So again, think of u as delta of t in this case. And draw a couple of asymptote lines here. So what is this value right here? That is exactly tau squared, right? That's as delta t starts pushing down towards zero. That's what tau squared is. So if my variogram estimate is above, so this is the point zero here, is above that point zero, that's giving me an indication of what the measurement error in the process is. You guys with me? As I start pushing over in time, how much variation is coming just measuring the same subject at the same time. Okay. This line, as I'm going here, and it starts to dissipate up, oh, that's this thing, right? That's this function that's pushing up towards up to sigma squared plus tau squared, right? So now that means this distance here, I'm going to actually take this all the way up here. Sigma squared, right? You guys with me on that? So now I go sigma squared plus tau squared. That's where this thing is leveling off. This delta t is going off to infinity. This is total variation. So what's this here? That's the intrinsic correlation. So that's going to give me a visualization, if you will, of whether I have a random intercept or not, right? In other words, this is correlation that's basically existing no matter how far I go out in time. In other words, it's like that, if you will, that exchangeable process, or the compound symmetric. It says it doesn't matter how far I go out, I always have this common correlation that's always still existing. You guys with me? Okay. So, the utility of a variogram, again, is nice because it says, do we need to have a measurement error component? That's this distance. Do I have a serial process? That's how much this thing is kind of rising. And then, do I have a random intercept? In other words, intrinsic autocorrelation, that's the gap between the total variation that you're seeing in the response, and then where that thing is starting to level off as a function of time. So let me just give you guys a couple of examples here. And you guys tell me what I'm visualizing. So suppose I go through and I estimate gamma of u. Again, this is the thing I'm calling u. I like to think of it as delta t, because that's really this, you're changing time as you're moving out. And then gamma of u here. And suppose that I get the following. On that? Okay. Now, suppose that I had oh, I don't know, an example like this, where I have delta of t, which again, I'm calling that u, gamma of u, and my variogram ends up looking like this function here. So I basically got no serial process. I've got a massive random intercept, right? So in other words, I've got, so what is this actually indicative of? It's like an exchangeable correlation matrix, right? I mean, I've just got this common correlation at any point in time as I'm going on. That's what that's telling me up there, the fact that this thing is really flat, okay? And then I've also got measurement error in that process, okay? So measurement error, hold on one second, RC, let me write this down. So this is measurement error. High variation in random intercepts. So in other words, people just tend to be high or tend to be low, and there's lots of variation across the population. Little or no serial process. Okay, yeah.
Yeah, so what are the units we're like, well, obviously we're working in a squared units, but what I mean is, like, what is a little and what is a lot? I mean, why does only relative?
So it's relative to the total variation. I mean, that's the way you want to think about this, right? Is it's relative to the total variation that you see in the plot. If you think about dividing this thing up, and, I mean, that's the because the units are squared, right? I mean, they're not like units as in you measured y. These are, I mean, they're on variance components, right? But what you really want to think about is, here's my total variation in a process. In other words, if I took a cross-sectional sample and I just measured individuals and I looked at the variation that I would see and I would observe, how much of that is taken up by, what proportion of it, if you will, is taken up by the fact that people tend to be different versus they have a serial process going on versus there's just measurement error that's existing in the population with my instrument that I'm measuring with.
Yeah, so what I mean is, like, for example, if my instrument is like really noisy and for some reason, like, this is just huge and takes almost everything on this plot, but it doesn't mean that we don't have a serial process. Maybe it is still there. But
no, but it would take up a large proportion of what you're seeing is what I'm saying, right? I mean, so in other words, if you took blood pressures, for example, that's what you would start to see, is that this line here is going to rise way up here. Now, you might still have a gap here, but the relative proportion of that total variation is going to start to get really, really high. In other words, just the measurement error in the device that you're using is going to start to dominate largely the variance components for other aspects of the population. So is that okay?
Yeah. So one of my questions is rather, so what do we do with that? So do we, like, discard this variance component or serial component if we, like, from our model, if we think that it's...
No, not necessarily. I mean, it still might exist. It just says that you had better put in a measurement error component into your model. In other words, you better be estimating tau squared, right, at the end of the day. Yeah. So it doesn't necessarily mean you wouldn't... So here, I would probably be fitting an exchangeable correlation structure. You see what I'm saying? In other words, this is such a small component of my total variation that it doesn't do much for me to start estimating this row parameter as I'm going through. I tried to put in a little bit here so you can see that it's not just flat. I mean, I can make it flat. But the point is that I'm dominated almost entirely by tau squared and nu squared, the random intercept and then the measurement error process. So it's probably not even worth it, again, to include kind of an autoregressive process here. And by the way, we've talked about this before. All of these are simplified models, right? When I'm doing this, I'm trying to get as close as I can to the correlation matrix, and then not necessarily saying I'm actually. So if I were doing this, I probably wouldn't include a serial process.
Okay. But it depends on our goals, right? Because like, if you want to predict, then maybe you don't need to include it. But
yeah, and if it were your goal of prediction, then I would be looking at out-of-sample cross-validation estimates when I have serial process or when I don't, be able to assess whether that is different. But if I'm trying to obtain efficiency on these things and characterize these as good as possible, again, you're gonna see it on homework, right? Where you have a strong autocorrelation process, but I just assume an exchangeable gain back most of the efficiency. But yeah, I mean, if prediction was your goal, or if truly some people characterizing that process is their goal, right? I mean, that's really what they want to know, right, Marisol? I mean, so if that's the case, then I'd better fit it. I'll tell you that it's approximately flat, right? But I'd better fit. Okay. I said right, Marisol, because this time series, and she thinks a lot about autocorrelation processes over time. Okay. Good. Just one more example that I want to give, which is start to stretch out very quickly in time, these things start to look independent. So you can imagine that empirical correlation matrix that I had, it's like if I went out one step and that was to a year, it would almost drop to zero, basically a year. What I had there. Okay. Everybody okay with this? Seem like a reasonable way to start visualizing some of these processes? I mean, for me, you guys are right now starting to simulate data and look at spaghetti plots. Spaghetti plots are reasonable for this component, I will argue. They're pretty good. Your eye is pretty good at vertically picking up on random intercepts. Like, is there variation at a point in time, right? As you're going vertically across things. What you will find very quickly on the homework, I think, is if you start talking about kind of a random slope versus an AR process and you do spaghetti plots, good luck. I can't tell the difference between. No way. They both induce autocorrelation. I can't tell what the structure is. This starts to help me in seeing exactly what's going on and how quickly my correlation is dissipating as a function of time and what components that I need inside of that model. Okay. And a spaghetti plot will do nothing for random measurement error. It's pushing together the measurement error and the random intercept concept. Okay. Yeah. Here? Yeah. Of X I star of T?
Yeah.
X I star of T is just your response. So think about it in our case as FET measured on the I subject at a particular time. Okay. Oh, and I just realized I put a little I there. This is being CD4 counts per subject I at time t. And what we're going to do is we're going to subtract off the expected value, if you will, of the CD4 counts of CD for subject I at time t. So this would be their cohort. So it might be their age, and it might be their gender, etc. Okay, as we go. So we're going to have to estimate this, and then mean center the process, and they come up with this xi star. Okay. I'm going to actually put a smoother through time on it, is what I'm going to do. I'm going to try and get flexible as a function of time. Same thing, same trick I did with the residuals just a few minutes ago. Exactly. But it could have other covariates in there too. Like I could condition upon, again, gender, or I could condition upon age if I wanted to, and say, what is the conditional autocorrelation process after I've taken out these fixed effects? Okay. Yes, myself.
So this is for one subject?
What's that now?
These plots are for one subject.
So no, because what we're going to do is we're going to borrow information off of everybody, right? So I'm going to get, so what I've got here is I've got expectations, right? Well, let me go to my next slide, actually, because it's going to tell you this. So if you guys go to slide 25. And this will help maybe slash out a little bit with your question as well, right? So what we're going to have is we're going to have, oh man, I forgot it in here, right? So, well, we're going to have this residual, Rij, right, where we subtract off our mean values that are there. So now I'm putting it in terms of Rij because we tend to think about residuals now, right? So in the usual variogram process, people would say xi star, but this is just now a mean-centered response. And so we're going to assume that it has this particular form that we've been talking about. The goal then is going to be to plot down our residuals, the pairwise squared residuals versus the delta time in which those measurements were actually taken on one another. And if you think about it, this is nothing more than a plug-in estimate, right, of 1/2 times the expected value of xi t plus u minus xi t, okay, going back to the previous notation that I had before, okay. Right now, mean centered the process. Okay, so now, myself, going to your question, once I plot these things, I'll have one for each individual, right, and each time point, but the gamma of u is the expectation of that thing, right? And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to smooth over it to get the average at any particular delta t. And so that's how I'm going to gain information off of individuals. So I'll have particular time, particular point estimates for each of these, for each individual, but then I want to average over to get an aspect of what this gamma is. Okay.
So when you
put
that smoother,
yeah,
that would be a variable.
That's going to be that solid line that I just now had there. Exactly. It's the average of those square residuals, right? So what I'm doing is I'm implicitly assuming stationarity across people, right? I mean, maybe that's where your question was going. That's how I'm borrowing information, right? I'm saying that there is a general process that's defining how people are kind of acting as a function of time. I'm not allowing each person to have their own individual variograms.
If you
drop
those in the process and you meet people and you plot them to see if they're actually aligning with one another or if they're...
In longitudinal data, you normally are not going to have the amount of information to be able to do that. Like in our case, we're going to have like 7 points, right? And, you know, okay, so it's going to look like this. It's going to look like this. It's going to look like this. So if you had a ton of information, so if I had 10,000 points on a particular process, then absolutely I could do that. But from here, I couldn't possibly do that to be able to distinguish between people. Okay. Good. So on the course webpage in the STAT 212 functions, you guys have a function there. I have to admit, I ripped it off from Patrick Hagerty, so thank you, Patrick. So it's called LDA.variogram. LDA meaning longitudinal data analysis variogram. And so what Patrick is doing, I encourage you guys to read through it, but he's effectively going through, creating the residuals, taking the delta units, hitting them by 0.5, taking the difference in them and splitting them. This is exactly what I have on the previous page. So you guys follow right through, pick out each line of this code as you go. It's not that difficult. But it's just creating the pairwise residuals as a function of time as you move through. Now, what you need to put in are the response residual vector. In other words, y in this case is going to assume to be mean-centered in order to come back with the variogram. And then, so x is going to be your covariate as a function of time, usually. Okay? So, let me go ahead and do this now in the context of the max data. Do not want to do that. So what I'm going to feed into that variogram function, and I want to encourage you guys to go through the code, make sure you're understanding what's happening, is I'm going to feed in my IDs because I'm going to do it on the subject level because I have to match up observations within the subject, right? When you saw it first, talk about on the same subject, two measurements, u apart. I'm going to feed in residuals. Those are what I computed before. So those are the mean centered residuals with the natural spline. And then I'm going to feed in the year, which is going to be the time of the measurements for those residuals. So really quickly, if you look at, if you look at what the response is going to be, it's going to be a list that's going to have your delta y's and delta x's. Well, delta x is going to be u in our notation, right? Because that's the difference in time. X is like the predictor, time is the predictor. That's what delta x is. The delta y is going to be the difference in the residuals at any point in time, and then id is simply going to be the id to match up each of those values. And so, again, it's a list with three different vectors on each one. So now, if I take that response, so dr is just, say, change in residual, right? Like the derivative of the residual. That's what delta y is in the response. Dt is the change in time, or delta x, and what's given out of that function. Variance estimate is just the variance of all of the residuals. Those are all of the residuals that I have in the data set. So what is my variance estimate in terms of this plot that I had from before? When I take just the variance of all of the residuals that I have, it's like across all subjects and over all times. It's my estimate of the total variation, right, Tina? It's my estimate of the total variation in the population. So in our notation, that's nu squared plus sigma squared plus tau squared. You guys with me? So that's going to be that top bar plot. It's the total variation that I'm observing in the population. So now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to plot dr versus dt. So this is the difference in the residuals squared, one half of that. And then this is dt down here, the change in time. We had up to 7 years of follow-up on individuals. And that plot is not very nice when you do that, right? I mean, these are a bunch of different individuals that are going off in time, and what your estimate of the expectation in the residuals squared is. Two observations. So what you want to do is you want to smooth it a little bit. So I'm going to run a smoothing spline through it. And then I also put on that plot an estimate of the total variation. Okay? It's sitting up at the top. And so now, let me just put a title on there because we want to make it look nice, of course. So help me interpret this plot then. What is this telling me? There's a pretty big measurement error that's going on with CD4 counts, and that is absolutely true. Okay? You measure the same person twice, you get sampling. Okay? And so you're basically going to see different variation in people as you start to measure them twice. What was the other thing I heard? There's definitely a serial process, and that serial process is dissipating almost over the entire time that you're seeing this thing, right? Over all 7 years of follow-up. Okay. And then what else do we see?
So where's the top line in this case?
What's that?
Where's our top line in this
case? That dashed line. That's total variation.
So we don't have much of a random interval.
Yeah, so it's saying after the serial process, there doesn't seem to be a whole lot of within subcorrelation that's going on here. Now, the reason why that's true think about it in the context of the problem here. As I'm going out from 0 to 6 years, something happened in between that time period. So they get back to age I can. So that changes a whole lot of your dynamics and how you look relative to yourself. So it's actually not that surprising that as you go out from 0 to 6 years, I mean, something just shifted the entire system almost with inside of each person. That was the contraction of HIV. So it's really not that surprising that you don't have a whole lot of random intercepts, in other words, intrinsic autocorrelation in people as you go out 7 years, in this particular example. Okay.
I have a question.
Yes?
So the total variation that you calculated there, probably not a very good question, but do you think that has anything to do with the, if you just run a total S model in this case,
it's just my residual is taking some of the square. I didn't try to get the unbiased estimate. It's not n minus p. It's just divided by n. But yeah, so it's basically the MSE. Good. So if there's another thing that complicates this particular application that we have here, and that is that people enter the study with high variability relative to the time that they zero convert. So in other words, 0 to 1 years for some people might be literally they came in and in 1 year they zero converted. But for other people that were there 2 years before they zero converted, 0 to 1 years is actually still there. They haven't actually contracted HIV yet, right? I mean, so there is a mixing of these two subpopulations. So what I want to do next time is we're going to kind of refine the example a little bit. Think about from the time of contraction of HIV, focus on that group, because it's going to be a much more homogeneous group, and then say, now what happens to that serial process? And then I think, Arseny, your question about the random intercepts is going to come back, and you're going to start to see it more, because you're going to go, okay, now everybody has zero here means contraction of HIV, and now it's the same subject in the same state, and they're moving forward in time, so they look a little bit more like themselves as you go through that state. This is a mixing, so to speak, of pre-post HIV contraction that you're going on. So it becomes a little hard to interpret. Although I will say, you can see kind of a change in the slope, right? It goes here, and then it kind of goes up. You think about it like a stick. That's because people are starting to zero convert around that time. It's not perfect, but most of the people that zero convert around 1.5, 2 years in the study prior. So that's what class is going on. Okay, so we made it through this guy, so this is just a brief summary of the different things that we talked about. You can think about using each of them. Again, on Monday, we will do a case study walking through all of this and then model fitting based upon what we learned in a slightly